Good afternoon. New South Wales got a shocking wake-up call today. 633 new cases, up to 539 of them potentially infectious in the community, and sadly, three more deaths. These are pictures of ADF troops leaving their hotel in Bankstown this morning, the compliance operation ramping up in our west and southwest, where more than 80% of daily cases are still being detected. And as confronting as today's numbers are, the Premier says we still may not have reached the peak of this outbreak.
Hope this really reinforces the message that even if you think you're okay, don't risk giving the virus to those you love the most. Some of the stories we hear every day about the way people are suffering, the way people are seeing loved ones die, and the impact it's having is just devastating. So just stay home.
We will see more admissions and more deaths if these numbers continue to increase. We have a collective responsibility to do all we can to stop seeing those deaths.
But this is our glimmer of hope. These are live pictures from our chopper above a vaccine hub in Macquarie Fields. It's been like this all day and the lines only seem to be getting longer. Hundreds of people still queuing for kilometres to get the jab. With scenes like this, it's a good indication we're edging closer to the all-important 6 million mark, which will hopefully give us more freedoms. And the Delta outbreak is now no longer just Sydney's problem. Lizzie Pearl is with me. Lizzie, for over weeks now, we've watched the numbers creep up outside the city, especially in the central west, but now they seem to be really getting worse.
Yeah, they certainly are, Mark. When you think about it, a couple of weeks ago, regional New South Wales was pretty clear. Now we know that the Dubbo cluster has grown to 142. Now, overnight, 23 of those cases are from Dubbo. It's from Western New South Wales. 17 of those are from Dubbo. There's also been positive tests in Mudgee, Narromine, Gilgandra. If we go further west, 3 cases are overnight in Wilcannia, 1 in Bourke, 1 in Broken Hill. The spread is really far and wide. 15 more cases in Hunter, New England. Of those, Newcastle has 10, Lake Macquarie 3, Maitland 2, 3 cases in Shell Harbour, 1 in Wollongong. Tomorrow's figures, we're going to see a case, or at least one case on the Central Coast, another in Kempsey, and also with that wastewater surveillance program, we have seen some virus being detected in Yamba, Orange and Bathurst. So this is no longer Sydney's problem. This is definitely New South Wales's problem. And today, as a result of that, we've seen 5 teams of ADF personnel heading into Dubbo. Now today, as you can see there, they're handing out food packages. In the next couple of days, it won't be food, it'll be Pfizer. And their job is to get those vaccination rates up. Of concern is, of course, our Indigenous community. Despite all of the talk and the hustle to get these vaccinations into arms, it just hasn't happened. Less than 20% of the Indigenous population over 16 in Western New South Wales has had one shot. Less than 8% has been fully vaccinated. It simply isn't enough, given the level of virus now in that community. So hopefully that army personnel can get some work done. But it's going to be a gentle process because there is a little bit of mistrust there between army personnel and police, and of course health officials as well. So it really needs to be a softly approach in approaching those Indigenous communities. Here is Scott McLaughlin from New South Wales Health, who is on the ground in Dubbo, explaining just why these vaccine rollout needs to be sped up.
67% of our total case numbers are Aboriginal, with a growing number of non-Aboriginal people in our confirmed cases, around 40%. Kids between the ages of 10 and 19. Some more good news. More doses of Pfizer arriving in the region today and tomorrow. We've started to see the Australian Defence Force teams arrive in Dubbo. They're being prioritised right across Western New South Wales.
A lot of work to do there. Mm. Lizzie, a lot of these regions are in lockdown. Is there any sense that that could be extended?
Well, they're all in lockdown. Dubbo was put in a bit earlier on Saturday. That snap announcement came with just an hour and a half to go that the rest of New South Wales would be put into lockdown. Initially, it was a 7-day call. The Deputy Premier John Barilaro was asked about that today, whether that would be extended. He wouldn't say yes or no, but you'd have to think with the vaccine levels being so low, the virus, even just one case is too much, being so high, you'd have to think that is a possibility that it will be extended. And the apart from the call that came very late and there was a lot of rush around in the regional areas, he has promised that that announcement will be made sooner rather than later, Mark.
OK, Lizzie, thank you. Well, the Prime Minister has praised Qantas after the airline announced today that COVID-19 will be mandatory for all of its staff. COVID vaccine, I should say. Political reporter Fiona Willen explains.
Qantas boss Alan Joyce says employees who decide not to get a COVID jab are deciding that aviation is not the area for them. Today, the airline has announced its workers will be required to get a COVID-19 vaccine. Frontline staff, cabin crew, pilots, aviation workers and airport workers will need to be fully vaccinated by the 15th of November, although there will be exemptions for staff who can't get one for documented medical reasons. The CEO says this decision was reached after the company surveyed 12,000 of its employees.
Nearly 75% of our employees believe that vaccination should be required for all employees.
The airline has been commended by the Prime Minister for the way it went about this, but the unions say this isn't the right way to encourage people to get vaccinated.
They've come up, I think, with a fair and well-intentioned direction. So I wish them well with that.
Once you mandate at a company level, you provide a lightning rod for discontent.
The Transport Workers Union also claims that Qantas jumped the gun with this decision because it happened on the same day the Attorney General held a roundtable with 25 employer groups trying to work through the issue of mandatory jabs for workers.
Australia's rescue mission to save our citizens and Afghans from the hands of the Taliban has begun, with 26 people flown out of the capital, Kabul, under the cover of darkness. Live now to Federal Politics reporter Jonathan Kersley in Canberra. Jonathan, there's still plenty of more people to be rescued.
Yeah, there are, Mark. This is the beginning of an operation which will involve many flights, according to the Prime Minister. The first flight, an RAAF Hercules, was flown into Kabul last night. It left with 26 people this morning. They are Australian citizens and Afghans. And Scott Morrison said earlier today 3,000 Afghans will be taken in under the humanitarian visa stream this financial year. They'll include interpreters who worked alongside defence personnel during the 20-year war in Afghanistan. But the task of getting people out of the country is problematic given the security situation with the Taliban, and other nations are also racing to get their citizens out. The Prime Minister said Australia's embassy staff were actually flown out in May when the embassy was closed, and he stressed people who try to get to Australia from Afghanistan illegally will not be resettled permanently, but he did admit the task of finding those they are trying to rescue will be difficult.
It's impossible to overassume any certainty here. I should say, you know, it is a very uncertain environment. It's an incredibly uncertain environment, and it changes every day.
Yesterday, there were multiple kilometre-long traffic queues outside the airport. At one point, people were having to be lifted over gates into the airport. It is extremely challenging.
Human rights agencies here in Canberra say they've been inundated with pleas for help from Afghans in Australia who are worried about family in Afghanistan. Tom Tugendhat is a British MP and former soldier who served alongside Australians in Afghanistan. He says the handling of this military withdrawal could haunt the West for years to come.
This could become the biggest hostage crisis the West has seen in decades. I mean, it's heartbreaking. I don't know what to say. It's heartbreaking.
So Australia has started an evacuation, but many fear the humanitarian crisis has already begun, Mark.
Jonathan, thank you.